Church, it's so good to see everybody here. It's good to see everyone in the house of the Lord today on the one of the most holiest days in our beliefs. The day he defeated the grave, that's what this is all based on, that he paid the debt we couldn't pay because he loves me, he loves you, he loves every person sitting around you, he loves every person on this earth. And we're just so thankful that you chose to be in his house today and that you're here with us. We're going to open things up with a song. Sing along if you want to, or say hi to your neighbor, or get yourself situated. Man, we're easy like that. We are easy at this church. As long as you're here to worship the Lord, that's all we care about.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry?
Let me tell you about my Jesus.
Do you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all it's stealing. Ain't you desperate for some healing? Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong.
Miss Emily's got some announcements for us this morning, I think. Marvin is under the weather, and that's got to be really rough. when you have a stomach bug on Easter, that is rough. Y'all say a prayer or two for him. Get him back in the game.
All righty. Announcements for this morning. Congratulations to Casey Stringer and Cole Lettington on your marriage. Hope I said that right. Men's Bible study Tuesday, April 19th at 6 p.m. And then the ladies' Bible study is going to be on April 26th. There's going to be fellowship and snacks at 5:45. Then study is going to be 6:15 through 7:30. And then youth camp is going to be June 5th through the 9th. If you haven't signed up for that, I guess, go ahead and do that. And then the sewing ministry restarts this Thursday, the 21st, in the fellowship hall. It's from noon until 2, and if you have questions, contact Peggy or Martha.
Awesome. Thank you, Miss Emily. If y'all would, please, are the children going to children's church, or are they staying in here?
They're staying here.
Okay.
Staying
okay.
Here for now.
All right, kiddos, y'all with us. If you would, please bow your heads with me for the opening prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, we come to you, Lord, today on the most holy of days. This is the day that you defeated death. This is the day that the devil was pranced around. Then when that sun came up and he saw that stone was rolled away from the entrance of that tomb, he stopped in his tracks. You had defeated him once and for all. You paid a debt for us that we never could pay. We could never be good enough. We could never do enough good things because of our sinful nature, Lord. But you made a way back for us. Since it was something that we couldn't do for ourselves, Lord, you sacrificed your only son, Jesus. He hung on that cross, Lord. He died. He bled. He suffered. He suffered for the sins that we commit. He committed no sins, and yet he still paid the price because he loved us that much. When he was hanging on that cross, Lord, your word tells us he was thinking about every single one of us, and he was making a way for us back to you, Lord. We can't thank you enough for that, Lord. We ask that you be with those that maybe can't be here today, those that may be sick or traveling or having to work or whatever the case is, Lord. We ask that you just be with those people and remind them that you are the one true loving God and that you are always with us, no matter where we go, from the depths of the ocean to the farthest reaches of space, Lord, that your presence is in all of it. You created every bit of it, and there's nowhere that you are not. And if we ever feel lost, all we have to do is turn around, Lord, and you're there waiting with open arms to love us and comfort us and help us through the trials of this world, Lord. We ask that we take the message today, Lord, that we hear, and maybe we know someone that doesn't know you or that has misconceptions about you, Lord, that maybe you'll lead them to ask us about you, Lord, and that we can be an envoy to them and tell them about the good news of the free gift of salvation. The love you have for us, Lord, the grace and the forgiveness that you freely offer us. And we ask that the music service today, Lord, blesses everyone here and that it fills our heart with joy and peace of knowing that we have an eternal Father that will never leave us, never forsake us, that will love us eternally, more of a deep love than we could ever really fathom with our human minds, Lord. Yours is spiritual, it's eternal. We ask these things in our living Savior's name, Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, guys, if y'all would sing with us, we got some nice songs to do here. This is totally crowd participation. We're going to have the words up here on the screen. Please feel free to sing along. Whether you can sing, whether you can't sing, that does not matter. That doesn't matter at all. Just make a joyful noise for the Lord. Join with us on these, please.
Low in the grave he lay, Jesus my Savior, waiting that coming day, Jesus my Lord. Up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose the victor from the dark, domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. not keep his prayer. Jesus, my Savior, tore all the bars away. Jesus, my Lord, up from the grave he rose with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose the victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with
good this morning. Sounds good. What a blessing it is to get to sing to Jesus in praise.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Or evil, a victory win. There's wonderful power in the blood. Oh, yes, there's power, power, wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb. Yes, there's power, power, wonder working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion? This is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Yes, this is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Yes, this is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Yes, this is power.
You let that cleanse you one time. Y'all sound so good. I love the clapping. Man, just getting down. I love it. You let that blood flow over you one time and you trust Jesus. You just crack that door a little bit. You'll see miracles. You'll see amazing things happen in your life that can come from no one but Jesus.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is my. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. My story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting. lost in his love. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day.
Beautiful. Y'all sound so good this morning. So good. So good. God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died. Amen, amen, amen.
drive those nails in my head, laugh at me where you stand. Go ahead, say it isn't me. Will come when you go ahead and mark my name, my love for you still the same. Go ahead and bury me, but very soon I will. That you were wrong. Go ahead, try to hide the sun, but all will see that I'm the one. 'Cause I'll come again. Ain't no power on earth that can keep me back.
Such a beautiful song.
Miss Emily wanted to do a special for us this morning. It's called Red Letters, and she's asked us to play along with her. It's a beautiful song. We hope it blesses your heart.
Red.
Kids, y'all want to come on up, and our children's church is going to sing a special for you this morning. So give us a second to get everybody up here.
Is it complete with visuals? And
it's complete.
Wonderful.
With visuals.
Great, great, great. Ryan, you go run down there and jump in it. Actually, I think they're coming up here, looks like.
They are. They're going to come up here, and you're going to
go
down
there. Well, there you go. You go down there then, okay. Yeah.
Hey, guys.
No.
We can. I can set one up there. You set one up there in front of him. I'll set one up there in front of him.
Oh, Ryan, grab that guitar case, get it off the baby left up there. Y'all got to sing real nice and loud, okay, kiddos? Real loud. They're like, look at me like, man, what are you talking about? Y'all ready? Ms. Sherry, we ready? I can't see you.
You're ready.
Okay. I'll sing nice and loud.
Good morning, everybody. Man, it's good to be here this morning, and it's hot in here. If I see one person with a sweater on, well, never mind. Well, it's great to be in the house of the Lord, and my goodness, what a great song service this morning. I always love the, give them a hand. You know, y'all may not know it, but they put a lot of work in every week doing this, and we're so thankful for them and Sherry and the kids coming up and singing, and now I've got to try to follow all that. If you're here for the first time, we don't make you stand up or anything like that, but we would like you to fill out. There's some sheets of paper. Now, we did have these little cards, visitor cards, about this big. Then I got to where I couldn't read it. So we've made out some 8.5 by 11 now where I can read them better. They're on the back table, if you would, if you'd fill one out before you leave. We'd appreciate it. I want to thank Zelda and Jesse and the whole Britton bunch for the beautiful flower arrangement this morning. It's beautiful. And we thank y'all, and we're praying for you every day. Jesse, good to see you here, brother. Good to have you with us this morning. Depending on what the weather's doing outside, right now it's doing nothing. So, and since the kids are all going home with y'all, I guess we can, with wet shoes, I guess it'll be okay. But if it were to rain, we had it in here before. So where do y'all want them to gather afterwards? Okay, gather where you want to afterwards. We'll decide on that later. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most holy and righteous Heavenly Father, we come into your house this morning to celebrate that Jesus did truly come out of the grave, that he defeated Satan, he defeated death, he took the punishment of sin for all who will call upon his holy name. That glorious Sunday morning, the tomb that he was encased in opened, and Jesus stepped out just as he had promised. We say we're grateful, but that just doesn't seem like enough. We pray that you'll bless the service today and that you've been pleased with this service and that no one leaves this church today without placing their trust in what Jesus did 2,000 plus years ago. In Jesus' name, amen. As Jesus hung on that old rugged cross that we talked about last week, beginning at the sixth hour, which is noon, they counted from 6 a.m., so from noon to the ninth hour, 3 p.m., there was total darkness over the land. It was the ninth hour, or thereabouts, that Jesus said, "It is finished." He took his last breath, and he died. The meaning of those three words, "It is finished," paid in full. When Jesus uttered those words on the cross, he was declaring that the debt owed to God the Father was wiped out completely and forever. It wasn't a debt he owed, rather a debt we owed that is now paid in full, the debt of sin. Joseph of Arimathea went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. This took a lot of courage from him because he was a member of the Sanhedrin. These are the same folks that had condemned Jesus to death. However, he didn't agree with what they had done. In fact, it may have been kind of a secretive thing that he was doing, but he truly believed Jesus' teaching. And he followed Jesus, and he believed the coming of the kingdom of God. So Pilate confirmed with the centurion guard that Jesus was indeed dead. And when he told him he was dead, he gave Joseph permission to go and bury the body. If you think about it, it had to be a massive undertaking. You recall what we've talked about in last week, how the nails were driven into his hands and his feet. Now he's dead. How do we get him down? Nicodemus was with Joseph and helped in removing the brutality of the removing. You could just only imagine what they had to do. But when they had accomplished getting him down, they took that bloody, beaten, bruised body, no life left in it, and they cleaned it up. They cleaned it up. They wrapped him in clean linens. They placed him in a tomb. It was an unused tomb. In fact, it was the tomb that Joseph had carved out for himself when he passed away. After carefully placing the body in the tomb, they rolled a heavy stone across the opening. Joseph and the women were present, and they thought it was over. They left to go home and prepare for the Sabbath day. You know, apparently the disciples of Jesus had forgotten Jesus' words. He had promised that he would rise again. Not everyone forgot. If you have your Bibles, then I always encourage you to bring them. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 27, starting in verse 62. It says, the next day, the one after preparation day, the chief priests and Pharisees went to Pilate. Sir, they said, we remember that while he was still alive, that deceiver said, after 3 days, I will rise again. So give the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal the body and tell people that he has been raised from the dead. This last deception will be worse than the first. Take a guard, Pilate answered. Go make the tomb as secure as you know how. So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting a guard. The tomb was now sealed, and guards stood watch over it. For the disciples of Jesus, they felt that it was truly finished. The followers of Jesus then, they did a lot like we do when we have someone pass away. You know, they go into a state of shock. They begin mourning, denial, and many other things that cross your mind and you go into during this time. Here they were, the one they thought was the Messiah, the one that they were sure was the Savior, had died. And it left them very confused when this happened. How could their friend, who they had watched perform miracles, not save himself from such a horrible death? 3 days. 3 days had to seem like an eternity. 3 days, there was some rejoicing in hell. For 3 days, Satan was convinced that he had defeated God, as was his plan from the very beginning. For 3 days, the Jewish leaders and the Roman government patted each other on the back that they'd got rid of the troublemaker. But you know, we can sit back this morning and say, praise God, because they were wrong. John chapter 20. Read along with me. Starting in verse 1. Said early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved. You'll see that in several places in the Bible, and that the one that he loved was John. They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him. So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and he looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there. As well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. When he saw and believed that the body wasn't there. This is a very important verse, and I don't fully understand exactly why, but verse 9 says, they still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. It wasn't because they hadn't been told. But on that third day, something wonderful happened. Something miraculous happened on that third day. Mary is the first to come to the empty tomb. And in the other Gospels, it talks about a few other women that were along. But the first thing she sees is the stone is rolled away. And it scares her. She doesn't know exactly what to think about it. She runs to get Peter and John. They take off. They run as fast as they can to the tomb. John was the faster of the two, got there first. And when he got there, he just looked over. He just looked in. He didn't go in. And what he saw there was the grave clothes. Then Peter arrived. And when Peter arrived at the tomb, as expected he would do, he just went straight in. He also saw the grave clothes lying there. There was something unusual about that scene. It's an interesting thing. And at the time, they didn't seem to understand what that was. The cloth that covered Jesus' face was folded and placed on the gravestone where Jesus' head would have laid. Is that important? Well, yes, it's important. He was leaving them. He was telling them, he was trying to remind them one more time that I'm coming back. I've told this story before, but it's the greatest illustration, and I love the illustration about how this was. You have to understand the custom of that day. The custom of the Hebrew custom of the day was about the servant and the master. When the servant would go, he would make the table. He would set everything just like the master wanted it. He had put the forks in the place, and never understood why he had more than one fork. But anyway, they'd put the forks and the glass and the meal exactly how he wanted it. Then the servant would get out of sight. He could still see the master sitting over. He could still see the table. But he was out of sight from the rest of the people. And he stayed there until the master finished his meal. When the master would finish eating, he'd rise from the table, wad up the napkin, and put it on the table. The servant would know then, without speaking, the servant would know, it's time, I can go clean the table now. The wadded napkin meant, I'm done. But if the master got up from the table and neatly folded the napkin and placed it beside his plate, the servant would know what that meant. It meant, I'm not finished yet. I'm coming back. Peter and John and many others had walked with Jesus for all that time. They had watched him open blind eyes. They had saw him open deaf ears. They watched him raise people from the dead. And then they watched him die. And as they watched him die, all their hopes, all their dreams were shattered. All they could think about was, it's over. For 3 long days, they mourned his passing. He was their hope, and now that hope was gone. And then 3 days later, they find the tomb empty. What was their first thought? Not that he had risen, that they had been stolen. When they found the tomb empty, they were even more confused. With that napkin that was folded there. Jesus was telling them, I'm coming back. He was trying to remind them one more time, I'm coming back. I'm not finished with my work yet. But he left them this clue. And you know, I thank God today, and I know you all do too, that he's not finished yet. The tomb is empty. The Savior is alive. Jesus is not finished saving souls. The Bible tells us the reason he came to this earth in the first place. John 3:17. One of the most overlooked but greatest verses in the Bible. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Because of this, because of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, there are two kinds of people on this earth today. In the eyes of God, they are two type people. Those that are saved and those that need to be saved. Some believe a good person, you have to be a good person to be saved, and that the bad person cannot be saved. Well, let me tell you, the Bible will tell you that Jesus is a lot stronger than that. There's nothing you can do that's been too bad that God can't save you through Jesus Christ today. Also, no one is good enough to not need to be saved. Romans 3:23. I love the verse. It says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Whenever you're studying your Bible, reading your Bible, and you see the word all, go ahead and just put you a little highlighted dot on it. And every time you see that dot, think of yourself, because you're part of the all. There is no difference in sin to God. Sin is sin. In God's eyes, there are sinners that have been forgiven and sinners that are not, but certainly can be. I told this story once before. Billy Sunday, many of you may have heard Billy Sunday, an evangelist from years ago. He was preparing to go to a big city on a crusade. So he wrote the mayor a letter and he said, give me a few names of people that are in need of spiritual help. Well, Billy Sunday goes to the post office or however they got their mail back in those days. But he went several days later and he was astonished to find the telephone book from that city. The mayor understood that we all need spiritual help. Jesus is not finished reclaiming backsliders. A day before he died, now this is important, a day before he died, Jesus took the disciples aside and told them what was going to happen. He told them, I'm going to be betrayed, I'm going to be arrested, I'm going to be beaten, I'm going to be crucified. Told them all that. And wouldn't you hate it to have been one of those 12 when he made the remark, and one of you is going to desert me. One of you is going to turn me in. And the rest of you, when they arrest me, you're leaving. You're going to run from me. Of course, we've read enough about Peter to know that Peter said, not me, Lord. I'd rather die than run. I'll never deny you. Always think of Jesus maybe just shaking his head at Peter, and he told him, said, by tomorrow you will deny me three times. They arrested Jesus, and while it was happening, Peter's boldness left him. If you recall, he was standing at a distance. He wasn't about to get close enough to be associated. But he was standing at a distance, and a young lady said to him, "I know you. You were with him." Peter said, "Not a chance. I don't know him. Never known him." Again, he moves along. Another person says, "I know you. You were with this man." He got a little more mad this time. He said, "I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know this man." And it happened one more time. And then he got angry. He said, "I do not know the man." At that point, he heard a rooster crow. And it's exactly what Jesus told him would happen. Immediately when Peter heard that rooster, sadness and sorrow filled his life. For 3 days, he was in shame. He felt guilty. He was in misery, realizing that he had denied not only a friend, but he had denied the Lord. Imagine, if you will, try to put yourself in Peter's place. You've denied the Lord. You have denied knowing him 3 times. You're Peter. You're sitting in a room. You're grieving. You're mourning. You're so sad over the loss of your friend. And not only that, but what you had done by saying that he don't exist, that you didn't know him. And the ladies come in and they say, "Peter, he's not there. He's alive." You know that Peter was sitting in the corner in total shock then. And he may have asked them, "What did you say?" And they said, "He's alive. He's alive." And then they said something that had to have put fear into Peter's heart. Said, "Oh, by the way, Peter, he mentioned you by name. He said, go tell the disciples and Peter." The thought had to go through his mind, uh-oh. Why? He knew why, but he had to wonder what Jesus was going to say to him. Why didn't Jesus just say, "Go tell the disciples"? Because I am one of them, but now I've denied him and it appears I'm not one anymore. So he was worried about that. He wanted to know, I wonder if he's mad at me. But you know what Jesus did? Jesus asked him this question. He didn't cut him down. He didn't run him down. He didn't do anything. He said, "Peter, are you going to deny me again?" And then he asked this. He said, "Peter, do you love me?" That was the question. You see what it was? Jesus wanted to restore Peter into the fellowship. That's the real issue. You may be here this morning and you may have slipped away from the Lord a little bit. Maybe you've backslidden a little bit. Let me ask you, was there a time that you were right with Jesus just like Peter was? The real question is not, are you going to sin anymore? The real question is, do you love him? Because he definitely loves you. He's still saving souls. He's still going after the lost. He's still reclaiming his own. He's reclaiming those that have backslidden. There's a great story. Come on. Come here. Hang on. There's a story of this little boy. This little boy had been got in trouble with what he did. This is a great example of what God does for us. Got in trouble, and he was really upset that his mom was so angry at him. So there was a chalkboard on the wall where they'd put their grocery list or to-do list. And this little boy went over there that day, and he writes on it. He said, "Mom, if you're not mad at me anymore, please erase this." He goes up to his room. An hour later, he can't stand it anymore. He's got to go see. He goes down, and it's totally erased at that time. That's what God does for us. He takes our chalkboard with all of our sins written on it, and he erases it. So are you right with God now? Bring your sins, bring your transgressions to Jesus, the one that arose. Bring your sins. He's not going to rub them in on you. He's going to rub them out. That's all you can stand of me, huh, sweetie? Happens all the time. I think she's looking for a chalkboard. Yeah, she was grabbing for anybody that would reach. Love it. Love it. You know, and that's what it is. I love kids in church. I love them. It's wonderful. I wouldn't take a lot of money for that. But what I say, and Jesus won't rub in your sins. He'll just wipe them out for you, rub them completely out. If you're here today and you've never been saved, or if you're here and you might need to come back to God, let me remind you that there's a day coming. There's a day coming when Jesus is going to fold up that napkin for the last time. And when he folds that napkin up, it's over. It's done. He is truly finished. The last soul that's going to be saved has been saved. The last backslider that has come back home has come home. Don't wait till it's too late. Remember the story of the prodigal son. Got his inheritance and left. When he came back home, he was scared to death. And what happened when he came home? Daddy ran to him with open arms. Today, right now, the Father is waiting with you with open arms. Jesus is calling you home. On this Easter Sunday morning in the year 2022, we celebrate the day that made it all possible. The day Jesus arose from the grave. The day he defeated death so you never have to die. The day he rose, taking our sins and casting them away to remember them no more. The day that he proved that he would never leave nor forsake you. He hung on that old rugged cross in pain, in anguish, with the sins of the world riding on him. He died. He was buried. And on that glorious third day, Easter Sunday, 2,000 plus years ago, the greatest three words known to mankind came true. He is risen. And that means one thing: your sins are forgiven. You would if you'd stand. It's great to be here this morning. I hope that you've given some thought this morning, not to my words, but to the words of God. The words that God wants you and loves you no matter what you've done. You can't do too much that he won't love you. He loves you so much. So many people think that they're just too bad for God to forgive. give Jesus a little more credit than that. He loves you. If you want to come down this morning and pray at the altar, pray with me, or ask your neighbor next to you to pray, they'll all do it for you. Mike.
Bring it all to the table. Nothing he'd seen before. All your trials, all your worries, all your sadness, the Savior, and he calls. Bring it all to that table.
Go ahead and be seated for just a minute. Some of you may or may not know, but Jesse, we got a little surprise for you up here at the front. Your sister came this morning and is coming before the church to, she wants to be a part of us here. So this is Barbara Britton. We're so glad to have Barbara with us. Usually now we would dismiss and y'all could go visit with Barbara out in the lobby, but we're going to get to do something a little extra special this morning. We're going to have a baptism. Got one back in the back getting ready. And what I'd like for you to do is, Jim, if you would, after the baptism, if you'd come up and get Barbara and just lead her out into the hall. You can wait till we get through, or you're somebody. Barbara, we're so glad to have you here, Barbara, and when Jim comes after you, go out there in the lobby and we can all greet you, okay? Just have a seat there if you would. Man, it's been a great day. Great day. Could you go in and see if they're ready? You don't mind standing up in front of all these people, do you?